Hey everybody, this is Perch. It's the last week of Future State. So 8 weeks of comics and an interesting bag. I'll have another video up probably tomorrow talking about kind of some thoughts on Future State. I actually recorded it before the final week, so in classic Perch faction. And this week, we've got seven titles here. And this, I think this was my favorite week in terms of overall the comics. I definitely enjoyed Swamp Thing, I think. As the most of all the books, I think Catwoman was high up there, but this gave us a really good book in House of L. Aquaman was there, Batman, Superman kind of was in pretty decent shape. Suicide Squad had some interesting pieces to it. Dark Detective, there's some decent stuff in here, but let's go through it, each title here and talk about what we've got. Starting with House of L. So House of L was a pretty decent surprise. And I will say that Philip Kennedy Johnson, I have a lot of hope that he's on Superman for a while, because this is a far future story, thousands of years. And in many ways, you read this and I think to myself, this is, can we get Philip Kennedy Johnson on Legion of Superheroes now as well? Because there's a lot of aspects to this whole thing. I also guess I have some questions for Jeff Thorne, because we talk about the Red King in here. I'm curious how this connects into his Green Lantern story, or if it does, or if that's just a weird coincidence. I'll say in the negatives, just kind of out the gate, and this applies to almost everything Future State. There's some interesting breadcrumbs they set up, but it's really unclear from the way this is structured what's meant to tie in. You kind of assume or you hope, but the storytelling is a bit scattershot, and that's probably being very, very generous. And so as a result, the magic, they kind of, miss, or they leave on the table. Anyway, House of L, basically thousands of years in the future, Superman has gone off and basically created a universe of Clark, where he has many, many descendants, both that are, because he had lots of children with lots of different women, or there are people who have taken up the Superman shield, including members of his War World. He did ultimately liberate War World. We've got Blue Lanterns that have his shield. It's an interesting progression of some of the things Bendis was doing in his story, but also it leads to kind of the mythology of Superman and kind of the mythology of Krypton and L. There's some good stuff in here. At any rate, there's a mysterious force attacking, and sure enough, it is actually a Superman. It is the son of Superman and Cersei, proving that he gets around. But we get a mob of cloned Doomsdays. We get the Black Racer that we've been seeing in some of these other books. But it's curious kind of how. That's just left to be a bit of a mystery why the Black Racer is here and how they got co-opted into this. But it is good stuff. All this, of course, leads to the return ultimately of, the true Clark Kent Superman, and him basically kind of who's been away for a very long time. There's a pretty big story about what he's been up to in terms of basically fighting from a division that Cersei trapped him in, and some new villains, and it's some good stuff. This is a lot of mythology, a lot of world building that you get in a relatively small amount of pages, 42 pages, and it's left, wanting to know, is this, ultimately a destination Philip Kennedy Johnson wants to go into, or is this just creating another pretty major future mythology of what Superman will be? That's interesting too. So a lot of stuff in here. It's this is a solid little story, and it's there's a lot of material that can be picked up here. This was a huge surprise to me. I just was not expecting this level of story, and it's a good one. We switch over to Aquaman, which is also probably one of the strongest issues this week. The first issue was great, and this is continuing along this story by Brandon Thomas. Daniel Samfrey is doing a really good job with the art. The coloring is really solid in this. But basically, we hear the other part of the story 6 years ago, where Aqualas, the daughter Arthur Curry is stranded in kind of this other dimension. She doesn't know where she is. She's horribly injured. She calls out to the sea, which allows her to kind of formulate this this leg for herself so she can walk. But it's in conflict to her. It's always in her head, kind of tearing her down. And she has to learn how to survive. We get some really nice pieces interspersing around her relationship with Jackson and how he trained her. And of all the Future State books, this one, you'd like to see more of this for sure. But it also, it probably handles the two-issue format maybe better than most in terms of what it was trying to create. So really, really good stuff. I like the dynamic of her with kind of her ability to control sea life and ultimately on other planets, different types of creatures. She, of course, goes back, rescues Jackson, and the two of them kind of set out on their journey together. It's a powerful little story. There's a lot of good stuff here. It kind of escaping across this multiverse. This is good stuff. Where it goes from here, I don't know. Of all the titles, maybe this doesn't need to go anywhere from here. But it's just a good contained story. I like how both characters got some good attention with it. We flip over to Batman Superman number 2. I wasn't a big fan of the first issue. It was fine. But in this one, it's basically, this is the primer to set up the Magistrate and all of those storylines. As you know, I'm not terribly excited about any of that, but at least we answer some questions. So Jean Lun Yang does a good job here of kind of setting up what is, what will be, he fills in some blanks that were kind of puzzling and stupid about the Magistrate bit. We have Professor Pig here. He's basically going to experiment on Clark. There's kryptonite, and we don't know how they've got this kryptonite, where this has all come from. But basically, he's torturing, experimenting on Clark. And Clark is basically trying to save one person. Batman is kind of trying to respond to this growing threat of the Magistrate. We learn that the Magistrate has made these weird little rats and pigeons and bats with Clark's DNA in order to give them super eyes. It's super weird. And if you think about it too far, it gets very strange in terms of how they're using biological warfare. But it does explain a bit of, basically Professor Pig has kind of leveled up into bizarre, body experimentation stuff. There's a little bit of body horror in all of this. And as they clear it out, I did like there's a brief cameo by Animal Man. That's nice. But basically, Bruce tells Clark he's a liability. He can't be hanging out in Gotham. The Magistrate has figured out how to grow synthetic kryptonite, and it means he can't really be here. He can't beat the Magistrate. Clark says they're a terrorist organization. And he's like, no, they're not a terrorist organization. We invited them in. We voted for these people. This is a dumb argument. I get that they're trying to tie it into kind of current events, but you've got this this group, the Magistrate, who's doing, illegal cloning. They're putting body parts on animals to do surveillance, and they're stockpiling kryptonite with the intent to weaponize it. And they're making a fascist city. It's absurd to say, well, hey, we voted for these guys though, so we can't interfere. That's just being dumb. You've taken it to a dumb place. Regardless, Clark flies off, and this explains why he's not welcome in Gotham. It's a good thing the Magistrate basically only wants to control Gotham and has no desires to move out to the suburbs or go anywhere else. So that makes it easy, I guess, for Clark. Metropolis will remain just fine. And in America, we've got one city that's a complete fascist city with, fences and people can't move in and out. That's definitely how things would work. Sure. Why not? Anyway, moving along, Legion of Superheroes. This is potentially the final issue of Bendis's run on Legion of Superheroes. We don't know if he's coming back to it or not. Titles have not been solicited, but this feels like it could be an ending. And in fact, the comic does kind of end things. He picks up on some storylines he was doing in the regular series around Saturn Girl and basically there's a traitor in the Legion, and people believe it's Element Lad, but it is not. And so we go into a, you know, basically Saturn Girl discovers that it was her. And there's a lot of dialogue throughout this whole book. But we basically move everything along to the point where the reveal is that, you know, because she's psychic, she works at this network, this allowed people to kind of invade her thoughts and betray the Legion. And that's where we got to this whole place where the Legion has fallen. But they can pick themselves back up again. Saturn Girl can, you know, basically fight, you know, on the psychic plane and regain her control and you know, reform the Legion. You know, John Kent has returned, and the Legion is ready to fight again. The challenge is the Legion has had this, they're breaking up and they're scattered and they've got to come back together storyline enough that in two issues, this feels pointless, I think. And the other challenge here is that you've got that House of Elves storyline, which, you know, involves Brainiac and seems to do a much better job with future timing. Anyway, it kind of, if this is the final issue of Bendis's Legion of Superheroes, kind of ends in a whimper. Riley Rossmo, you know, you either love Riley's art or don't. I think it's pretty binary for people. I appreciate the different things going on. Certainly the comic looks very detailed and complex in certain areas. And I think Riley's art is fine. It's an acquired taste. But I appreciate the work that gets put into it. I like the different panel work that is done. There's some very interesting visuals here, and that's kind of cool. But in terms of a Legion story, it just, you know, it's easily forgotten, unfortunately, is where it lands up. Suicide Squad has two stories in it. So we have the continuation of the new Suicide Squad, which is Amanda Waller's, like, not quite the Justice League going up against Peacemaker's, you know, random collection. And we basically, you know, it's an interesting enough story in the sense that we get some big reveals that they're not necessarily on this planet, that there is a different Earth in play here, that Connor Kent, why he's working with Amanda and who's double crossing who. There's a lot of pretty interesting pieces here. Definitely a lot of you thought you knew what was going on, but you don't kind of stuff. And so it's, you know, it a lot of head explosions. and it as a story, it's fine. It doesn't necessarily get you anywhere. Maybe this is a primer to kind of get you excited about the idea of Connor Kent working with Peacemaker and with Amanda Waller. But this end reveal of, you know, no more neck bombs, no more deaths, no more Tax Force X, and Amanda's like, that's my boy. And it's like, yeah, okay, but you've been doing this for how many years now? It seems odd that we're here. But anyway, how this ties into the Suicide Squad ongoing that's coming next month, who knows? But, you know, I there's nothing inherently terrible about this story. It just doesn't... you're left, you finish it, and you're left kind of what you just read, I think maybe is the best way to put it. Our backup story is Black Adam. And Black Adam, we kind of, two things dominate this story. One, we've got, you know, this new character, Gold Beetle, which is a female combination of Booster Gold and Blue Beetle. And, you know, with all the kind of insane trappings of the two characters, she meets up with Black Adam, who is now The Rock, completely down to, I would be completely unsurprised if somebody didn't trace, you know, Rock poses and head mannerisms, because there's this is absolutely The Rock is now Black Adam, which I didn't think I'd dislike as much as I do. But so they're basically attacked by the crime syndicate and by kind of these threats from other dimensions. They fall into, you know, we get a pretty interesting walk through a number of different aspects of the DC universe, from the Speed Force wall to New Genesis to Skyland and the Tower of Fate. We get to reintroduce to a number of magicians who have been kind of long lost. I'm not sure what Big Barda is doing there, or Barba. I'm not sure. Was this a misspelling or I don't know. Maybe it's just some other universe version of Barda. It feels like an error, but yeah, what do I know? But anyway, we get this kind of basic conclusion of the nothingness is coming to rip out everything. I guess it's the unkindness is coming to rip everything through. This loosely ties into some of the stuff I think that was going on in Shazam. At least it's in the same kind of world, so it does kind of fit that together. But Shazam, Black Adam, sorry, not Shazam, Black Adam basically makes a deal with the wizard that kind of acknowledges that he is the champion, and he spins backward through time and is trapped in the Rock of Eternity, which is in hell in 2021. So Black Adam is trapped in the Rock of Eternity in hell in this year. How this sets up Justice League, who knows, but okay. Black Adam has this additional knowledge. So I guess this either sets up Justice League or it just kind of gives us a very grim outcome. Not sure. Or we're in a weird time loop where there's a different Black Adam in the Justice League and this is a Black Adam that came through past that's trapped in hell. So that can be I don't know. All right. Two more issues here. Superman versus Imperius Lex. I mean, on the outset, as I mentioned last time, I am not the big Mark Russell fan. I know some people enjoy Mark Russell's writing. Some people do not. If you enjoy it, you're definitely getting Mark Russell here. If you don't, you're definitely getting Mark Russell here. So it's really what is up for you. In the last issue, Luthor, who is running a broke and screwed up planet, he's this rich kind of land developer, tycoon that is faking his wealth and power in order and has basically tricked a bunch of sycophants to love him. I'm sure there is absolutely no political analogy that we're currently thinking that applies here. Anyway, he's joined the United Planets, which means he gets to saddle them with all of his debt. Lois comes down to kind of investigate all this and question his totalitarian no voting regime. But they discover a wealth. They discover dirithrium. They discover red crystals that are basically super, super, rich. It makes him rich and powerful. Lex is very happy about this. Lois reminds him that because he joined the United Planets, that it's a big socialist collective, that all that wealth also belongs to them. So everybody benefits, and Lex then immediately wants out of the United Planets, but Lois won't let him because she enjoys taking it to the patriarchy. And of course, revolt happens. Lex tries to turn evil. He murders some of his own people. Sure, Superman flies down. There's a battle, and basically they kick Superman off the planet and terminate Lexor from the United Planets. Lex is happy about this because he's got his cave full of crystals, but bad news, Lois and Superman have screwed with Lex and basically synthesized, made cheap knockoffs of these crystals in order to drive down the global price of all this, and now he's poor again. So it's over. This title says to be continued. Where? I have no idea, but somewhere. Sure. I think if you like Mark Russell, you like this stuff, this comic was probably pretty clever and pretty, pretty great. It definitely feels a little bit like Superman in the 70s in the sense that Superman's screwing with Lex and it has that kind of feel to it. It's not for me, but it may be for you. It's your call. Finally, Dark Detective, the last issue of four of the Mariko Tamaki, Bruce is poor. And he's lost his fortune and he's got to somehow rebel. We get, more shenanigans going on with the magistrate and Peacekeeper One. And so he, our lead peacekeeper, who is our lead peacekeeper? He's got the red hair of the, Commissioner Gordon from back when he was in that super heavy storyline. Was that the name of it? Anyway, he was Batman for a while. It's not Gordon, but sure, he's here and he's all scarred up. It's fine. Anyway, this young girl who chastised Bruce for not, you know, knowing anything and being kind of a dope. It turns out she's working on the inside of the magistrate to steal some of the technology to bring him down. Bruce realizes that drones are about to come in and wipe everybody out. And so he's got to save them, which he does. And this is where he has a nice little argument with the girl. And she's braver than he is. She's going to get in and really save things from the inside. Meanwhile, Bruce is going to suit up and have himself a big old explosion fist fight with Peacekeeper One, which he does. And meanwhile, Hannah gets the data and heads out. All right. And maybe he's dead at the end. Maybe not. He blows up a big building. He may or may not be in it. Don't know. But he's burning it all down. And the woman who is his spy on the inside has the data, and she's going to do stuff with it. This is kind of an unsatisfying conclusion to this dark detective storyline, but you could tell it was going in this direction. Does this all matter? I don't know. If this is the future, then we're basically committing ourselves to 5 to 10 years of cyberpunk, magistrate, fascist control Gotham, of which I have no interest. That's going to kill off. It is going to kill off people being interested in Batman. I'll just say it. Anyway, our backup story is the Red Hood story by Josh Williamson, Giannis Milogenis, and it's fine. Again, the Red Hood is been double-crossed. There's a price out on his head. Ravager is after him, but he manages to not only get away, but secure the old Red Hood helmet, get in with the White Rabbit, and basically kind of double cross her, hand her over to the magistrate, and this allows, and we get some hints about we have the same boss, the magistrate's pulling all the schemes once again. Okay, I don't care if the people voted for the magistrate or not. You've got a fascist terrorist organization that's randomly blowing stuff up, having drones. This wouldn't happen like this in America. Sorry, it wouldn't. Even the most ardent anti-Trump person would say you're not going to have a city controlled this way. And then Superman's like, well, I can't do anything over there. They voted for Nakano. I got nothing. Anyway, so the Red Hood's name is cleared, and he continues to do his deep undercover work. He meets up with a mysterious voice. We don't know who this is. I think we're led to believe kind of it's Bruce, but could be anyone. And off he goes. And this is going to be continued in the Future State Gotham story, which is all about Red Hood and his new Red Hood. And that's it. So we also this week got the Generations Forged issue, which is a quite a good little issue. I mean, it's fun. It's definitely got an Avengers Forever vibe. We won't go into it here, maybe in a different time. It is giving us the gift of the Linearverse, so that's that's something for another time. But it strikes me that if you're reading DC this week, you do have some decent Future State titles. All in all, I won't go into the whole thing, but it's not bad. You did get this week a Batman's Second Son, which continues the story of Jace Fox, and you also got a Nubia Real One OGN, which in theory continues the adventures of Nubia. Unfortunately, that Nubia Real One bears zero to anything. Like if you like Nubia from the Immortal Wonder Woman comic and you pick this up, you would be all kinds of confused. But that's a story for another day. And the Batman Second Son, I don't know. I really like John Ridley as a director. I'm not liking this. I don't know. Maybe something's off, but that's just me. Anyway, that's all Future State. What did you buy? What did you like? Are you glad it's over? Are you ready for next week and Infinite Frontier Zero and the start of the new DC Universe in March? Let me know in the comments below. Like and subscribe. Get in touch with me with all the stuff in the description. Point it all out. And thanks for listening.